Hello everyone. Narcissist Free Almost here, and today I wanted to talk about sabotage and the pathological narcissist, what types and why, as well as where it originates. First, for the survivor, heck, for anyone, the types of sabotage and the reasons for it, the pathological narcissist inflicts, are mind-boggling to say the least. It's taken me a better part of a decade to walk through all the bizarre things intentionally done to me. And the most unbelievable part is that they were meant to impose maximum damage. I believe that the biggest hurdle for survivors to come to terms with, is that the person, who was supposed to have your best interest at heart, is the one who is deliberately sabotaging them. The secret malicious intent behind the narcissist's seemingly innocent facade, is by far, the hardest thing to deal with, and believing that it's even real, that someone can be so evil and wish you so much harm, becomes one of the most important roads to travel down, allowing you to alleviate somewhat the rage and revenge fantasies you will undoubtedly experience. That said, what is the goal of sabotage? What you need to understand is that it is meant to damage the target, bringing all of the attention back to the narcissist, as well as elicit emotional responses in the target to ultimately break them down. If that sounds evil, it is. And something I like to keep in mind is a very simple definition of evil, which is, the absence of empathy. Next, what are the most common types of sabotage people, in narcissistically abusive relationships, experience? I'll begin with the first category I call deliberately deceitful communication. Here, when trying to communicate with the narcissist, they will be vague and deliberately leave out important information you need to make an informed decision. This automatically sets you up for failure. They will obfuscate. For example, they will not follow through with plans, or change plans at the last minute. This is a one-up move to maintain the upper hand. And my all-time favorite is forgetfulness. It can range from the smallest thing like forgetting to take out the garbage every single week, to forgetting bigger things like paying bills. Did that electricity get shut off? Are you so sure that wasn't done on purpose to get back at you for something? Just ask the narcissist that was supposed to take care of that, and for sure, he'll deny it. They will also be dedicated to misunderstanding you, and where circular conversations come in. They'll keep you on a hamster wheel of trying to explain something, knowing full well what you meant to begin with. This is a fun exercise for them, as they are able to maintain control of the conversation, enjoying all your attempts at trying to make things clear. Later the bonus for them will be to tell everyone they know, how unraveled you become over little things, promoting the perception that you are somehow unstable. In the second category that I'll call malicious gaslighting, the narcissist will pile on the work. At home the narcissist will be MIA typically using excuses like I gotta work, when they really aren't at work, or lays around diddling with hobbies and so-called home improvement leaving you with all the chores and parenting. They will enjoy their free time, watching you scurry around, harried and overwhelmed, while ignoring all your efforts, making you feel unappreciated. By the way, that is not incidental. The narcissist will be chronically devaluing you and moving goalposts with the express purpose of making you feel bad, and therefore more easy to control. At work, the narcissist boss will pass on projects to you, keeping you too busy to really be effective. This, again, is a strategy to keep you in the one-down position and to set you up to fail. They can never let you succeed or outshine them in any way. This can be very subtle, and for sure it's devious. A narcissist will sabotage your sobriety by making your vices readily available, enticing you to indulge. Be very sure of one thing. They will use this against you at the first opportunity. They will agree to things you want done, want to do, or want to have, then 5 minutes later say they never agreed. This keeps you guessing and confused. And a great way to ruin any fun you might have planned. And let's not forget about sleep deprivation. A narcissist delights in ruining a good night's sleep in order to ruin whatever important event you might have the next day. They will start arguments right before you go to bed, or might stay out all night to keep you up wondering where they are. Reactive abuse has to be, by far, one of their favorites. Narcissists love this type of abuse because they get to be the bully on the playground. They will poke, nitpick and prod to make you blow up, or they'll start arguments just before you're ready to go to an event. Of course the end goal is to always make you look like the unhinged one, and them, the innocent victims of you. They will be sure to make you late in some way, and while you're feeling rushed and frazzled, secretly feel very pleased with their handiwork. If you have a self-care routine, forget it. If your attention isn't 100% focused on them 100% of the time, they will make sure to ruin that as well with all the above-mentioned strategies. The last common strategies that I'll call just plain cruel covert sabotage, is when they turn others against you, even your own children, behind your back, using triangulation that enables their smear campaign. The end goal of these strategies is to isolate you, and separate you from others that could potentially support you. Remember, the narcissist envies you and wants those good relationships you have all to themselves. In fact, they feel entitled to everything you have. Keep in mind these people are morally insane, so using your children against you is just par for the course. In their minds, you deserved it anyway. As long as they get what they want, no one else matters, not even the damage they do to their children. Lastly, there is abuse by proxy, yet another fun sadistic game they play. Imagine the power they feel when someone you know and love goes after you, or stops talking to you altogether. They get to watch your despair and confusion, knowing they're the ones who caused it, and to them that's power, the power to affect you in every way, and eventually the power to destroy you completely. One of the major factors behind the sabotage is competition. Know that the narcissist is always in competition with you, and that is the reason they're with you in the first place. Again, they feel entitled to you, as well as all your friends, your good reputation, and basically your identity. They want people to like them the way they like you. So what if they discard you, and now you're doing much better, which often happens when the victim leaves? That will be grounds for a smear campaign, because how dare you do better than them, how dare other people like you better, and how dare you do this to them, you are supposed to be suffering. Are you doing and feeling better after the divorce? Can't have that now, so the narcissist will, over time, turn the children against you. After all, the narcissist needs all of their attention on them, and they need them to hate you as much as they hate you. Are you doing better at your job now after leaving the narc? Be sure they'll cozy up to your coworkers or boss, and promote hateful rumors. Heck, most of the time they won't even be true, but that doesn't matter, the goal is to get you fired. Never ever are you supposed to be happy, let alone be more successful than the narcissist. I know in my experience my ex-malignant narcissist did this right in front of me, and I had no idea. We were at my daughter's swim meet, and my boss happened to be there for his daughter, and the narc walked right over to him and started talking. I looked back to see him smiling smugly, arms crossed in an arrogant manner, and chatting away. My focus, of course, was on my daughter, so I didn't give it a second thought. A week later my boss was setting me up to be fired, and it was so bad, I had to quit the next week because I could see the writing on the wall. I had no idea what was going on, and would confide in the narc my dismay and sadness. He would listen attentively but not really convey any sort of emotional support, of course. Incredible when I look back, and I think about him looking so innocent pretending he had no idea what I was talking about, all the while knowing he was the one that did it. Can you imagine being a person like that? To this day it still blows my mind. And that's how dangerous narcissists are. It took me many years of 20/20 hindsight to figure this all out. And these are the things I know for sure. Just think about what I didn't figure out. Slimy, disgusting, revolting, still aren't big enough words to describe my ex-malignant narcissist. And believe me when I say, he never, ever lost a single night's sleep after his psychopathic follies, or ever, for anything. That tells you something right there. How the people around him haven't figured this out by now, and beat the living daylights out of him is a complete mystery to me. Remember, this is an all-pervasive disorder, so, if they're doing it to you, they're doing it to everyone else. Moving on to the third concept, where does all this creepiness come from? How does someone become like this? Where does this type of aggression originate? The answer boils down to envy. Pure envy that springs from primitive aggression never fully processed and integrated in infancy. Recall that the infant sees the world in part objects, all good and all bad. Through the process of integration, where the infant tolerates ambivalence and begins to embrace the process of mourning, Both good part object and bad part object come together, resulting in better emotional regulation, as well as promoting higher level cognitive functions, such as reason, compassion, and sublimation. Starting with the narcissist's temperament in infancy, primitive aggression wins over libido, and a transformation takes place, where that primitive aggression becomes the core affect of hatred. Hatred then becomes characterologically anchored, meaning that hatred becomes the lens through which reality is perceived. As a side note, you need to know the difference between normal jealousy and narcissistic jealousy and envy. Normal jealousy is something we all feel from time to time, and a normal person will contain and suppress this emotion, and choose to do something productive about it versus acting out. For example, a young woman sees her friend excelling in college. The jealous one might first decide that she doesn't like this person anymore, and might even feel slighted. She may rationalize her feelings by telling herself that this friend doesn't deserve her achievements, and it's not fair that she perhaps comes from money, or that she doesn't deserve all the supports lavished on her. Over time, that won't feel good because it's not entirely true. She realizes that she's the one that really wants to go to college, and why can't she make that happen for herself? Using her mature defenses, she would ask her friend questions and learn her friend's strategies for success, applying them to herself. And then she's on her way, discovering that her jealousy could transform into action, believe she can also be a successful college student, and most importantly grow to appreciate her friend that taught her that lesson. Using this same example, where a young narcissistic woman is pathologically jealous and envious, she would set out to destroy her friend's success and happiness. The narcissist's jealousy would trigger that ugly primitive aggression that was never processed in infancy, and she would perceive the friend as deliberately withholding happiness she believes belongs only to her. She might start a smear campaign to turn all her friends against her, telling them she doesn't deserve all her success, and she's really not that smart. She might even sabotage her friend by calling her late at night with fictitious problems, depriving the friend of much-needed sleep for the next day. She will create chaos and drama, confusing and exhausting the friend, all in effort to destabilize her in hopes that she gives up, quits, and relents to the narcissist's attempts to put her in the one-down position. Again, the pathological narcissist's development went terribly wrong at the very beginning of life. In favor of power and domination, they sacrificed any hope for any real happiness or peace of mind. They cannot change, nor do most of them want to, but if they did, any type of change would only be behaviorally and not in the brain structure where the problem lies. They will always be envious, jealous, wanting, and unsatisfied, leaving a body count hardly any of us could imagine. Sabotage is what they do to alleviate their feelings of unworthiness, incompetence, and inferiority. But some might even feel sorry for them once they realize this fact, but you would be wasting your time. As far as I'm concerned, they deserve those feelings because that is the reality of who they are. They won't make efforts to do the actual work to succeed and grow, that's beneath them. The arrogance of that attitude should be enough to wipe any empathy or compassion you might hold for them away. They don't deserve it. Just ask yourself, have they ever bestowed genuine empathy or compassion on you? Yeah, I didn't think so. Just remember, evil is the absence of empathy, because without the fail-safe mechanism of empathy stopping harmful behavior toward others, you could do anything to anyone, which is exactly what the narcissist does. Oh, and by the way, be able to sleep like a baby at night. Well, that's it for today, and if you found this content helpful, please subscribe, give a thumbs up, and be sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss any new content. Also, you can find me on Facebook at NarcissistFreeAlmost, and on Instagram at Clumber_Lover with a U. As always, sending you all my love and gratitude, and I do hope you're living peace of mind narcissist free. I know I am.